for the love that moved you to the cross, Lord. Thank you, God, for your sacrificial love. How you choose us. How no cost, no price was too high for us. Even in spite of all of our failures, our flaws, our weaknesses, our sin. You look at us and you say, we're worthy of your love. We're worthy of that great sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. What love moved you, God, to go for us? What love that is. You loved us before we even knew our need of you. And we're so thankful. Let's lift this to him as a love song. Would you sing it straight to him this morning? Because you first loved me.
Never leave me. You are.
it's leading me home. I trust that every moment's in your hands. You're the God of my days.
Yes, Lord,
the King of my nights. Lord of my laughter, sovereign in sorrow. You're the Prince of my praise, the love of my life. You never leave me. You are faithful, God of my days.
Yes, Lord, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you,
my
Jesus.
My eyes are on you. My faith is in you. My eyes are on you. My hope is in you. My faith is in you. My eyes are on you, Lord. My eyes are on you. My hope is in you. My faith is in you. You're the God of my days, and the King of my nights, Lord of my laughter, sovereign in sorrow. You're the Prince of my praise, the love of my life. You never leave me. Sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the strength is failing. The end draws near and my time has come.
We declare that there's nothing too hard for you. Lord, there's nothing too big for you. No adversity, Lord, no adversary that's too great for you, Lord. You're greater than all those. We worship you, Lord Jesus. What a blessing, what a privilege to join together, Lord, as brothers and sisters, to worship you and to exalt your name. You are indeed King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Lord, we are overwhelmed, we're humbled, we're in awe of who you are. Lord, we glorify you. Help us to get a bigger glimpse of who you are, Lord. And faith would rise up in our heart, Lord, as we see that your power and your majesty is greater, Lord. There's nothing too hard for you, Lord. There are situations that we face that are too big for us. They're too hard for us. Lord, they're beyond our finances. They're beyond our ability to make a difference. But, Lord, they're not too hard for you. And we place these at your feet, Lord. We come into your presence in Jesus' name. Amen. What a privilege that we have, friends, to join together. We come because of the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed upon the cross. We come with boldness. We come with confidence. The author of Hebrews writes, we enter into his presence. Because of what the Holy Spirit applies that to our lives. Not because of who we are. You know, according to the Old Testament, if you went into the presence of God, you'd be struck dead. But we are covered by the blood of Jesus. And we can enter into his presence. When Christ died upon the cross, that veil was torn in two. Now we have complete access into the presence of God. And we can present our needs and requests before him. How many with uplifted hand all across the congregation would say there's something you're praying about today?
Hallelujah, yes.
A lot of hands.
Hallelujah, yes, Lord.
Amen. God knows your need. I may not know your need, but God knows your need.
Yeah.
Amen. He knew your need even before you did. Amen. Let's lift these up before the Lord today. Father, we thank you, Lord. We rejoice in the privilege that we have to come into your presence, to worship you and glorify you. Because you are worthy, Lord, to be praised. And we pray that faith would rise up in our hearts, Lord. Faith would rise up in our hearts to believe for a miracle, to receive a miracle, Lord. We pray the prayer of faith, Lord, not our ability, but your ability, Lord. And we pray that as our faith, we join our faith together as men and women, Lord, and join together in your presence, Lord, that we would see great things by you. Lord, we pray that you'd heal bodies, heal minds, heal hearts, heal relationships, Lord. Provide finances, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We pray most of all for spiritual intervention. We pray for salvation of loved ones, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Those who are far away from you, may they hear your voice and say yes to you, Lord. In Jesus' name, say yes to the wonderful life, the wonderful salvation you offer, Lord. Abundant life now and eternal life forevermore. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name I pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. God bless you. Amen. All right. Well, I'm excited today. Praise God. All right. Well, we're going to let the kids go off to kids' church at this time. And again, I want to thank Joanne for her faithfulness. What a blessing Joanne is. God bless you. And for all the kids that are part of that, thank you so much. And we look forward to more. We know during this time there's some people are hesitant to come out. I'm glad you're here. God bless you for making that choice. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. Well, last week we talked about the fact that God created man and woman. He created Adam and Eve. And some time had gone by, and Adam was staying out late for a few nights, and Eve was getting upset. When Adam finally got back home, Eve accused him of wild living. "You're running around with other women," she charged him. "Hey, you're being unreasonable," Adam responded. "You know, you're the only one for me. In fact, you're the only woman on earth." Well, the quarrel continued until Adam fell asleep, only to be wakened a little bit later, sometime by someone poking him in the chest. It was Eve, of course. "What do you think you're doing?" Adam demanded. "I'm counting your ribs," Eve replied. She wanted to make sure God hadn't made another woman for him. All right, we're in the series entitled In the Beginning, God. We're looking at the first five chapters of Genesis. And today we're looking at the mystery of marriage, and we're looking at Genesis chapter 2, verse 23 and 24. And I don't know if you noticed this, but in the news just this weekend, on the East Coast, Savannah, Georgia, there's a couple celebrating their 100th birthday. His 100th birthday was on the 7th, just on Friday. And her birthday is on the 11th, on Tuesday. They're both turning 100. They've been married for almost, they've been together, I believe married that whole time, for almost 80 years. Amazing. I think they were high school sweethearts. When asked what their secret is to living such a long life, the husband replied, "All I know is work hard, whoever you're working for as an employee, go to church, love the Lord because he's the one taking care of us." That's pretty awesome. I know when that time came for us, and it was August 1977, and I was back home for the summer on Kauai from being in school here in the Seattle area. I was back on my home island of Kauai, and Shirley was going to come and visit us. She was visiting first her sister and brother-in-law, her brother-in-law was stationed in Schofield Barracks here on Oahu, and then she was going to come for a week and visit my family. She said it was really quite an experience because what was happening was first time she's meeting my family, she's moving in for a week. And this, a couple days before she came, I remember vividly a conversation with my parents. We were in the car. I can still picture them. Dad's driving the car. Mom's in the front passenger seat, and I'm in the back. Dad said, "She's coming all the way out here. Have you told her you loved her yet?" I said, "No, I haven't." He said, "You mean she's coming all the way out here and you haven't told her you loved her?" I said, "No, I haven't." I'm thinking, Dad, it's your fault. Because Dad told me that right before he got married, not long before, a very abbreviated premarital counseling, that the pastor said to my dad, hey, you're marrying this beautiful woman, but what would happen if not long before you got married or right after you got married, something happened, she's in a terrible accident, she's horribly disfigured, or she's injured and handicapped, and you'd have to take care of her the rest of your life. Would you be able to do that? And I thought, that really messed me up. You know, could I say that to her? You know, I liked her a lot. I had a lot of affection for her, but could I really say that? You know, I mean, she was attractive. She was vibrant. She was energetic. Could I still say I would want to marry her if I would have known that, you know, she's terribly disfigured, not attractive anymore, and she's incapacitated, I'm going to have to take care of her. Could I do that? Well, I decided that I could. I thought I could. So a couple days after she arrives, our church that my dad pastored there in Lihue, we're having a potluck in Lydgate Park. If you're familiar with that, just north of Lihue on the way to Kapaa, real nice park, great place to have a family picnic. So our church is there. And after the meal, I was asked to wash out one of the ice chests, one of the coolers. And so Shirley comes with me, and we go away from everybody else to a faucet. And there's a big park bench there. I said, well, Shirley, would you sit down here for a moment? I have something important to tell you. And so she sat down, and she could see that I was very serious about what I was going to say. She waited for me. I said, Shirley, I think I love you. She said, you think? I said, I love you. What was her response? You'll do. No, she didn't say that. That was a pretty momentous moment. I'll not forget that. We came back to the group. The little, dear little saint, Sister Kuma, that had sent us away, said, how come you took so long? I thought, if you only knew. That was a life-changing moment. You know, we didn't get married for over a year. In fact, we didn't get engaged for almost a year. But our definition of love was such that we knew we were only going to say it to one person. So when I told her I loved her, she told me she loved me, we knew we were going to get married. It was just a matter of time. And so that was a very defining point in our life. And so, as I mentioned, she was staying with our family for about a week, and then we were both flying on the same plane back to the Seattle area. I was going to continue my studies at Northwest College, now University, and she was going to continue at Seattle Pacific University. And so we're here on the plane together for that, you know, 5.5-6 hour flight back from Honolulu to Seattle, first from Lihue to Honolulu, and then from Honolulu to Seattle. And so I thought, this is my girlfriend. We, we're not engaged yet, but, you know, we're definitely at a new level, whole nother level in our relationship here. And I thought, you know, I'm going to pay for some headphones for us to listen to, you know, so we can watch the movie and listen to music while we're on the airplane. Now, you have to understand, I'm very frugal, very frugal. And this was especially hard for me because when we used to fly in the planes, those headphones were free. And then they started charging $5. I thought, man, they're making money on this thing. So, you know, I'm half Norwegian and half part German and English. You know, I mean, it's just in me. I'm very conservative with money. But I thought, I'm going to be generous. I'm going to pay for these headphones, and so we can watch the movie. But my wife, girlfriend back then was so excited. We were going to get married at some point. She wanted to hug the whole flight back, and I couldn't even use the headphone. But that was quite an experience. Marriage is a gift of God. It is a blessing. It can be the closest thing to heaven on earth, but it can be the closest thing to hell for some couples because they're not practicing good biblical principles. One thing we know for a fact, God created marriage. God created marriage. It is not a human institution. It didn't evolve through culture. And because of God created the marriage, then we need to understand the Christian biblical principles about marriage, not what society tells us. So Every couple that I marry, and I haven't done that for a while, but in the past I've done that a lot. We go through four sessions, 2 hours apiece. I mean, it's a lot, 8 hours worth of stuff. And I share a lot with them, and I'm going to share a little bit this morning, some of the things that I share with them. And one of the things I share with them is the definition of love. And I don't remember where I got this. It's very good. Love is an unconditional commitment to an imperfect person. We spend, I think, most of one session talking about love because of misconceptions about love. It's an unconditional commitment to an imperfect person. That's very good. Love is when meeting the needs of another person becomes my most compelling need. You know, a lot of times in our society, love is about what you can do for me. But love is not about getting. Love is about giving. And so what happens is a lot of times people think, well, you're not giving me what I want, so I'm not going to give you what you want. You know, and then it becomes this negotiation. It becomes a real problem. But if we understand love is about giving and that is an imperfect person, they're not a perfect person. If we understand it's about giving, then if we continually give, we give to that person, they're giving to us, well, then that's going to be a great thing. I'm not sure exactly where these came from. Maybe from H. Norman Wright. I know that this came from him. I use his book as the basis for some of the things I shared, premarital counseling. H. Norman Wright is a well-known Christian counselor. He talks about marriage and many other topics. And this is his definition of marriage. Very good. A Christian marriage is a total commitment of two people to the person of Jesus Christ and to one another. It is a commitment in which there is no holding back of anything. A Christian marriage is similar to a solvent, a freeing up of the man and woman to be themselves and become all that God intends for them to become. Marriage is the refining process that God will use to have us develop into the man or woman he wants us to be. Now, we could spend all morning just on that last sentence. That's a very powerful sentence. It is the refining process that God will use. So if you have friction in your marriage sometimes, hey, God is using that person to help you learn things and help you grow to become more like him. A Christian marriage is a total commitment to two people, the person of Jesus Christ and to one another. And so, you know, the way we looked at it when we first got married was as a triangle. There's a triangle. Jesus Christ is at the top. And I'm on one side, Shirley's at the other side on the bottom. The natural inclination of relationship is draw close to one another. Well, that's important too. But in a Christian marriage, as you draw closer to the top of the triangle, you're actually drawing closer to one another. So Christ comes first, then that person comes second, and that's the way it needs to be. And when it comes to love and marriage, it's not automatic. It's definitely, marriage is hard work, friends. In fact, the two most important things in life, marriage and parenting, ironically, excuse me, dry throat, I don't have coronavirus, I promise you. The two most important things in your life, marriage and parenting, if that's what, you know, the plan God has for you, you have little or no formal training for it. Now, if you have a job, if you go for a career, you're going to have 1 year or 2 or 4 years of schooling or more for that job that you might not even have for the rest of your life. But marriage and parenting, you have little or no formal parenting. Basically, what you learn is what you experienced in the home where you grew up. And that's another almost entire session that we go through, the, you know, the background that you have and how you come into it. You think you're coming from the background, same background, but I can promise you, you aren't. And so the main thing that you have is what you learned at home growing up. And that could be good or bad. You know, if you have a dysfunctional home that you grew up in, a dysfunctional upbringing, then you can have real problems. The great philosopher Socrates, Greek philosopher, lived in 400s B.C., is known as one of the founders of Western philosophy, very influential. He put it this way, by all means, marry. If you get a good wife, you'll become happy. If you get a bad one, you'll become a philosopher. I thought, well, who knows? Maybe that's how Socrates became a philosopher. The key is this. There's no such thing as a happy marriage. That's why I tell couples that are married. There's no such thing as a happy marriage. They're going, what? It's just two happy people who get married. You'll never find your fulfillment in another person. You have to find your fulfillment in the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, and thankfully the Bible gives us a good foundation, and we're going to look at some of those things today. You know, friends, I tell people I would not want to get married if I didn't know Christ was the foundation of my home. You know, the Bible speaks about being unequally yoked. So as a pastor, I do not marry couples that are unequally yoked. If one's a Christian, one's not, we kind of marry them. Now, if both are Christians or both non-Christians, I can marry them. But I tell the non-Christian people, I say, you don't have to become a Christian for me to marry you. But I would not even want to think about having a marriage without Jesus Christ as the sure foundation. Because Christ invented marriage. God invented marriage. And the way that it's best accomplished is through scriptural, biblical principles. And that's very important. So let's look at our passage of scripture today, Genesis chapter 2. We're looking at verse 23 and 24. Genesis chapter 2, verse 23 and 24. Let's start with verse 22. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. Verse 23, and the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. And we looked at that a lot last week. Today we're looking at verse 24. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. The man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. Amen. Well, let's pray together and ask the Lord to open our heart to receive his word. In Jesus' name, Lord, we thank you for the privilege of studying your word. Thank you, Lord, we don't have to ask for your word to be anointed. Your word is anointed. But Lord, we ask that our hearts be open and anointed to receive your word, and that your word, the truth of your word, would be planted deep within our hearts, Lord, and that we would not just be hearers of the word, but doers also. It would affect our lives. I pray that in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Now, not everyone will marry. We looked last week at 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7. Paul, in the context of marriage, says that God has given every single person a different gift. He, Paul, himself, his gift was singleness. And so for some people, for a time, or maybe most, if not all their life, they might be single. So there's nothing second class about that at all. But most people will marry. And I would like us to look at the three parts of Genesis 2, verse 24. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother. First word is leave. Second word, be united to his wife, cleave to his wife, and they will become one flesh. That's the third one. And we're going to look at them in ascending order and more as we go along. So the first one is this, leave. And we're going to leave physically. And leave father and mother, form a new family, is what God is talking about here. Now, for most of our marriage, my wife and I were in the Seattle area, and I was almost 2,700 miles away from my parents. They were west, and all the other relatives were about 1,700 miles east. I was in the middle and didn't have anyone around. Shirley was only about about an hour away, give or take, depending upon where we lived. About an hour away from her mother, but she knew she couldn't go home. There was no back door, no escape clause that, hey, if this didn't work out, I'll just go back home. There was none of that. Well, now our situation is reversed. She's about 2,700 miles away from her mother, and I'm about 20 miles away from my dad. But we are called to leave physically and emotionally. We're called to leave emotionally. Newlyweds, I share this with couples that are married, don't try to go back home. You know, there's no escape clause. Hey, if this doesn't work out, I'll just move back home. Your home, friends, is where your spouse is. Your home is where your spouse is. And parents, don't let your children come back home after marriage. Now, here in Hawaii, we have a lot of ohana homes. And so I understand that, you know, families moving together because it's expensive. That's understandable. But Your children should know that if they move out of your home, you know, they're not coming back by themselves. Now, if they need to move back, that's fine as a couple, but you're not letting the door open for them to move back in case it didn't work out. So one summer when I was away at college, I spent a summer working for Roseburg Lumber Company, as I mentioned, down in Southern Oregon. Stayed with a good friend from college. His name was Bob Long. And his sister, he had a married sister, and she was having lots of marital problems. And there was really some issues there that were going on. And she had been married for some time because she had at least two kids, maybe more. And I vividly remembered when she came home, the marriage fell apart during that summer. When she came home, her mother was triumphant about it. You know, I thought that is the wrong attitude to have. There should have been heartbreak. Now, does divorce happen? Yeah, it does. But that should break her heart. That shouldn't be triumphant. You know, it was like, well, hey, that was a bad marriage. I didn't ever like that guy in the first place, and I'm glad you're out of it. That should never be our attitude. So we're called, number one, Adam says, prophesies, for this reason a man will leave his father and mother. Or this could be an editorial from Moses. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife. Cleave, the next word is cleave. Cleave, now that's a confusing word. Now I know what a meat cleaver does, and I brought one along. I know what a meat cleaver does. You can use that to cut up your meat, though I'm not sure how to apply to marriage, except if a wife chases her husband with one, if she finds out he's been cheating on her. So, you know, this is a really good... by the way, if you don't remember anything else, this is the secret to marriage right here. Just threaten that. No, just teasing. Cleave, actually, if you have an older translation, King James or others, they use the word cleave. Cleave is a kind of a confusing word because we only think in terms of that definition. It actually has two, more than one definition, but the other definition is the exact opposite of that. So, for example, according to Merriam-Webster Dictionary, cleave means to divide by or as if by a cutting blow. So you would cleave meat with a meat cleaver. The next definition of cleave is something that's exactly the opposite. It means to adhere firmly and closely or loyally and unwavering. It means to cling or, as some translations use, like I did this morning, be united to your wife. To your spouse, be united. So this is the command, friends. It's not to divide or split, but to adhere firmly. Here's the command: be united to one another, be joined together, be yoked together, be glued to one another. You know, have you ever worked with super glue? Okay, you have to really be careful. You have to watch out because if you get that and you stick your fingers together, they could be permanently glued together, permanently adhered. Yeah. You know, some of you might remember that ad for Crazy Glue that was in the 1980s or later, and it was about a guy in a helmet, and he put some crazy glue. That's what it was. It was for crazy glue. You put that on the helmet, then they would put it on a cross post, and there he would be dangling from that cross post, holding on to his helmet because it bonded that quick. Well, let me tell you, friends, God desires to super glue your union together as husband and wife. He plans to crazy glue you together. God has chosen you, he's joined you together, and he declares no one shall separate your union. Matthew chapter 19, verse 6, Mark chapter 10, verse 9, Jesus declared, what God has joined together, let no one separate. And we often will make that statement at a wedding ceremony. What God has joined together, no one must separate you. We must cleave to one another. We must be super glued to one another. Now, this has a couple of implications, of course. The first one is to marriage and spouse, and that is this: do not break the union God has given you. Do not break the union. God has put you together. He's super gluing you together, and you do not have the luxury through unfaithfulness or divorce to break that union. Flirting might seem exciting. It might seem very enticing, very attractive. Divorce can be very easy. We live in Hawaii and in the state, when I went to the mainland, where most of my pastoring was in the state of Washington, Both that state and this state have no-fault divorce. You can get divorced very easy in these states. But like a toxin, it can destroy you. Friends, after you cleave, you do not leave. It's as simple as that. Now, over the years, I've counseled a lot of couples who were in turmoil. Their relationship was trouble. Now, I haven't done that for a number of years, but earlier years in my ministry, I've done that. I'm not a professional counselor. I tell people that from the start, but I'm happy to listen to them and share what the Bible has to say about them. And so a number of couples have come to me over the years, and they're having troubles, and they don't say it, but it's written all over their face. I can read it. I can read them like a book. They're going, can we survive this trouble? Can we survive this trouble? That's their question. And friends, that is the wrong question. Because my wife and I, we've made a commitment to one another. We're going to talk about that more in just a moment. We made a commitment to one another, so we never, ever ask the question, are we going to survive this? The question is, how do we resolve this? How do we deal with this? How do we overcome this? Because we already settled the question, are we going to survive it? We already answered that question. Yes, we're going to survive this. It might kill us, but we're going to survive. The question for us is, how are we going to resolve it? So someone might be thinking, you know, I would never do that. I would never flirt. I would never cheat. I would never be unfaithful. I would never walk away. But we need to be careful. The scripture warns us about pride. Let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. And pride sets you up for a tumble. It's easy to go from flirting to the real thing. You've heard it said, the grass may look greener on the other side of the fence, but you still have to mow it. That's a very good statement. So flirting and unfaithfulness will destroy your home, ruin your life. Many of you, I know I'm speaking to the choir, so to speak. You know these are true, but I want to say this for the benefit of each one of us and for those who are watching us online. Friends, you will find, I can guarantee you this, you will find whatever you do is not worth the price. You'll find breaking that union is not worth the price. So, for example, look at the life of David in the Old Testament. David is a man after God's own heart. God loved David. David experienced victory after victory after victory after victory. You can watch his life. It's an upward trajectory. He's growing and going up and up and up. And then he meets Bathsheba. And with Bathsheba, he's involved in immorality. They conceive a child outside of marriage. He's involved in conspiracy to kill her husband, to get him out of the way. First try to get him to, you know, get him to think the baby is his. And then he actually is involved in the murder of her husband. Now, does God forgive David for that? Yeah, read his confession. I think Psalm 91, powerful. God forgives him, but David does not bypass, he doesn't do a detour around the consequences, because we will experience the consequences of our decision. And you look at David's life, as I mentioned before, it's going up, 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 and up. But as soon as that happens with Bathsheba, his life is going down, down, down. His family falls apart. His son begins a coup against him to take away the kingdom. I mean, his life is going down. I mean, we see this. It's a tragedy. We saw it in my wife's own life when she was only 13. Her father left the family. Her father was a very proud man. I only met him a couple of times. Shirley and two of her sisters got married within 6 months. Her next older sister in September, her youngest sister her next older sister got married in June. Her youngest sister got married in September, and then us in December. And the only time I met him was at those two other weddings. But he was a very proud man. I mean, you couldn't tell him anything what to do. You know, he would hold court, kind of, so to speak. Later on, he came down with cancer after he'd been gone went to a different state, didn't even go to the first daughter's wedding, said that his ex-wife had put out a restraining order that he couldn't even enter in the state, which was not true, heartbreaking as that was. But he went away and got married and had another child, and were gone to another state, many states away, long ways. And then he came down with cancer, and the daughters wanted to see him one last time, so they put together money, and they flew him and his wife and the daughter up to the Seattle area where they could see him. And I suppose it could have been the chemotherapy he was going through, but I don't think so. He was an absolutely changed man. Every time I looked at him, I think he was crying. Because I think he was seeing, for the first time, the cost that he paid. Because he's seeing daughters he hasn't seen for a long time. He's seeing grandchildren, many of whom he had never seen before. And he's seeing them, and he's weeping almost that whole time. I thought, wow, I wish every dad who's thinking about walking away could see this picture right now. And because at the time you think, hey, it's easy, no problem. So the first implication of being united to one another, as I mentioned, is for marriage and the spouse. The second one is actually for children, for parenting. The statistics of divorce, children divorce are devastating. 50% of all children in the United States will experience a divorce. They'll witness the end of a parent's marriage. An additional 50% of the children, in other words, 25% of the first group, an additional 50% of the children who witness a parent's divorce will also see the breakup of a parent's second marriage. Children born out of wedlock are 24% more likely to see their parents divorce. That's why it's very important getting married first. That's what God's plan is. Children of divorce are 50% more likely to marry another child of divorce. Children of divorce are 35% more likely to have a divorce of their own, which is pretty amazing considering the four girls in Shirley's family, all of us have been married. Like I said, three of the four girls, the three younger ones, got married within 6 months. And we're all celebrating this year 42 years of marriage. And the oldest sister, she's celebrating, 44 or 45 this year. So they've had long-term marriage. But that's unusual. That's an unusual thing. But, you know, at that point, that was the point where Shirley made a commitment to the Lord. She thought, well, I can't rely upon man. I can't rely upon family. You know, my dad's gone. And so she turned to her Heavenly Father. And that's where she really made a commitment of her life to the Lord. And so, you know, the statistics about divorce, I don't know exactly what they are, but what it's been is that it's been the same inside the church as outside. And that should not be. So we need to cleave. We need to be united to one another. And then Genesis 2:24 goes on to say, become one flesh. Become one flesh. As I mentioned last week, God opened the side of Adam and took out their rib and made a woman, made another person. And it's been said that marriage is the process of opening up your side, your heart, and becoming one again. That's a very powerful picture. Become one flesh. And that's a picture of sexual union. It's a picture of cleaving, of adhering to one another, becoming one flesh, literally. Today we're going to look at the emotional and spiritual significance of that. And the first word is this, commitment. I'm going to share three words with you. The first word is commitment. We become one. We become one. We make a commitment, and we become one. Now, what is the opposite of a commitment, friends? It's feelings. Feelings that many people go into a marriage based upon the feelings they have for one another. And feelings are wonderful. What's the problem with them? They're misleading. They're deceptive. They're not something you can depend on. Now, where would all the love songs be today without feelings, you know? I can't live without you. Feelings are powerful. But I have a question for you. What if you woke up one morning and you had no feelings at all to the person next to you? What if you had no feelings at all compared to the person, you know, toward the person next to you? that your spouse there in bed? What if you woke up and you had no feelings toward that person? Well, that was the experience of an author by the name of Dennis Guernsey, who wrote a book called Thoroughly Married, which I happened to come across when I was a freshman in college several years before I met Shirley. And, she can be thankful I came across this book, because that book helped me to understand that it's not primarily about feelings. Now, feelings can be wonderful, but you cannot rely on feelings. So you might one day feel nothing. I think that's the reason why many people walk away after a certain period of time, maybe 7 years. Maybe that's why they call it the 7-year itch. After 7 years, you go, why am I sticking with this person, and you see another man or woman at work, and they begin to look really good, and things at home are bad, and things are feeling not real good, and you ask yourself, why should I continue in this? I'm not appreciated. This other person's going to appreciate me more. I've never understood that. Hey, I'd rather get involved with somebody I have no idea who they are. Things are going to be better with that. Friends, marriage is not based on feelings. It's based on choices. And so you make a big choice the day you get married. That's your big choice. But then every day you have to make the little choices. Those choices every day. Some days I can feel very passionate toward my wife, very excited, very loving. And other days I can feel nothing, or at least very little. But I am committed to her. No matter what comes, no matter what happens, I am committed to her. I have already made the choice. We both made that choice. We are married to one another until death does us part. I made that vow. She made that vow when we got married. We're in it for life. And we would often say when we first got married, because there are things that come up and you're not used to them and they're uncomfortable. And we would say to each other, well, you better get used to it. You're stuck with me. We'd say that in a positive way. And we'd laugh over it. We'd go, yeah, it was a reminder. We're married for life. We're married for life. When you say, I do, friends, you did. Or if someone said, put it this way, how to know if you're married to the right person? Short answer, look at the name on the marriage certificate. When you go after some 5-10 years of marriage, wow, did I marry the right person? Yeah, look at your marriage certificate. You married the right person. Now that, by the way, is John Piper, a well-known pastor, who said that. And he's right on that. When you said I do, you did. So I'm committed to my wife with all that I have and all I am, no matter what my feelings are. When the positive feelings are there, hey, that we enjoy them. And the other times, when the feelings are there, we're not ruined by it, we're not devastated by it. It's because we've made a commitment and we're not basing a relationship on feelings. By the way, the same thing is true for your Christian life. And your relationship with the Lord, there are some days you think, wow, I feel really strong in faith. And other days you think, why does God even bother with me? Hey, you don't base it on those feelings. You base it upon the Word of God, His commitment to you, and you're making a choice to make that commitment to Him. So we make a commitment to one another, and we also make a covenant to one another. See, even more than a commitment between a groom and a bride, we made a covenant. We made a vow before God when we got married in our wedding vows. And Shirley and I, we take those vows very seriously. We made those vows before God and before man until death do us part. And it's tempting to walk away. It's tempting to look at others. Hey, when you get older, you notice other people. You might be older, but you're not dead. You're not blind. But we are committed to one another, and we do not take the chance to sin against God, friends. Now, what I tell every couple I marry, I tell them this, that it's all about a covenant. I said, in the eyes of the state of Hawaii, I as the pastor am the one who joins that couple together, in the eyes of the state. I'm the one who legalizes the marriage, the ceremony, I sign and submit the documents, I sign the license. They have my name, my autograph for the rest of their life. I tell a couple, though, I don't marry you. God does. God is the one who's joining you, and I'm just a witness to what he is doing. And we need to make that very real in our lives. Now, according to the state, I might be the main witness, but I am a witness. And everyone there in that congregation who witnesses what they're doing, they're witnessing what God is doing. And that they're now wed for life. They're now married for life. God is super gluing them together. And one person said it this way. In the beginning, In the beginning, God did not make a church or a cathedral. He made a family. In the beginning, God did not appoint apostles or prophets or pastors, etc. He appointed a husband and a wife in the covenant of marriage. In Genesis, the first mankind gathering was a wedding ceremony when God joined them together. It was not a worship meeting. That's how important marriage is. After God, the next thing that came was marriage. Wow, great statement. So, commitment, covenant. There's a third word I want to share with you, intimacy. Literally, one flesh has to do with intimacy. We're going to look at that more next Sunday. What does intimacy mean? People have described it by the word, intu-me-si. Intimacy, intu-me-si. I open my life, I open my heart for you to see something in my heart that no one else sees. We want to have that intimacy before God, intimacy before a spouse, intimacy before someone else. And those are different areas. Now, friends, God has a plan for you as a couple that you grow together first spiritually and then emotionally and finally physically. It's that triangle. God at the top point, you two at the bottom. The closer you grow to him, the closer you're going to grow to one another. You grow first spiritually and then emotionally in union with one another, spiritual union, then emotional union, and then a physical union. Unfortunately, most people, get that relationship backwards. Instead of starting off with a spiritual intimacy and spiritual union, emotion, then moving on to emotional intimacy, and finally to physical union, what they do is they are attracted to someone physically, they join them physically, they become involved in sexual union right away, and they hope they'll hit it off emotionally, so they get married, and they often ignore the spiritual dimension. They have it exactly backwards of what God wants. And that's a recipe for disaster, friends. It's a recipe for disaster. And I've talked to a lot of young people in the past. They say, oh, God just wanted to spoil our fun. And you know what? That is not true. God is not trying to spoil our fun. He is there to safeguard our lives. Safeguard our future. As I mentioned before, let's say a couple gets involved in sexual union before marriage, children born out of wedlock, 24% more likely to see their parents divorce. When my wife and I got married, we had never been involved with anyone else physically before. So we didn't have to compare each other with anyone else. We didn't have to deal with that. And I'm so thankful for that. The fact that, friends, that this intimacy and the fact that, you know, people are starting their relationship backwards. It's a recipe for disaster, as I mentioned. I came across a survey a number of years ago that I share with couples that are married. I'm not sure how current this survey is today, but maybe it's true. It's probably true, not hopefully, but sadly it's true. What I say is this. According to the survey, of all these people that were surveyed, 5% said they had a happy marriage. 5%. 5 out of every 100. 10% said they had a good marriage. And a full 85% said they had a tolerable or legal marriage. They just happened to be living together under marriage. And let me tell you this, friends, God does not want that kind of relationship for you. My prayer for every couple I marry and my prayer for you is that you'd be part of that 5%, that you have a more than a happy marriage. It'd be a blessed marriage, a joyful marriage, an overflowing marriage, a Christ-honoring marriage. The next Sunday, we're going to look at intimacy and sexuality from these verses, verse 23 through 25, be PG-13 message. It's a good thing we're having kids' church now. As I mentioned, either everyone's going to show up or everyone will stay home. We're going to go to prayer in just a moment. So why all this talk about marriage? Number one, it's the next topic in Genesis. That's what God's dealing with here in Genesis chapter 2, verse 23 and 24. That's the first marriage. God performed that marriage. But it's also where we live, friends. This is where we live. Most people, not all, but most people, many people are going to get married. And your marriage, your sexuality is important to God. And my personal belief, my conviction from Scripture is this. Your marriage should showcase the glory of God to the world. Your marriage should be overflowing with the love of Christ for one another. And people see the blessing of that, and they wonder, how in the world do you have that? See, our world is full of broken homes and broken marriages. And it's tragic. We don't need more of that. We need people to display the glory of God in their relationship. And that can be a witness to people that you know. As they see the love you have for one another. Wow, how come you guys can love each other through this difficult stuff? Well, because we put Christ first. Christ is first. And as we draw close to Him, we're drawing closer to one another. You know, it's Ecclesiastes 4:12. Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. There's power in three, and when you are married, there's three. If you have a Christian marriage, you have three in that relationship: God, husband, and wife. And we say, Lord, we want you, Jesus, we want you to be glorified in our marriage, and we want you to be the foundation of our marriage. Now, friends, whatever your relationship status is this morning, whether you're single or married, what matters most is your relationship with Jesus Christ. And I want to challenge you to surrender your life, commit your life to Christ. If you're married, commit your marriage. If you're single, commit your singleness. If you hope to get married, commit your future relationship, your marriage to the Lord, to Jesus Christ. And say, Lord, I want you to be the foundation of everything in my life, every relationship, especially this marriage relationship. How many of you say amen to that? Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. God bless you. You've been very patient today. Thank you so much. I had so many things I want to share today. Many other things, but we're running out of time, so we're going to go to prayer at this time. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, I commit every life here to you. Every man, every woman, every young person, Lord. I commit every person to you, Lord, that you would be the foundation of every life. I commit every marriage to you, Lord, every husband and wife. And I pray that your glory would be revealed and be displayed in every home, every marriage. Lord, that there would be something unusual, different about these homes. Lord, that friends and neighbors and relatives would be so drawn and attracted to it. Why? Because you are the foundation in that home. You are the one that is the super glue in that home. Your Holy Spirit is the one making the difference in that home. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to invite you to spend some, to have a some time with the Lord. If you want to come to the front, you're welcome to do that. We're going to sing that song, In My Life, Lord, Be Glorified, and then In My Home, In My Marriage. Amen. Amen. Lord, I lift it up. In my marriage, Lord, be glorified. Be glorified in my marriage, Lord, be glorified. And in my work, Lord, in my work, Lord, be glorified, be glorified. In my work, Lord, be glorified. One more, in your church, Lord. In your church, Lord, be glorified, be glorified. In your church, Lord, be glorified today. So if you're married, commit your marriage to the Lord at this time. If you have a spouse that can't be with you, lift up that spouse today. If you know some homes, especially those that are troubled, would you lift them up, pray for them, that God would bring healing to their marriage. In Jesus' name. If you're not yet married and you look forward to that sometime in the future, commit that marriage to the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's lift it up to the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift up our marriages, Lord. Thank you for my wife, Lord. I pray your blessing upon her, Lord, and our home. Fill our home with your Holy Spirit. Lord, let our lives be, and our home be a display of your glory, a showcase of your glory, Lord, and of your love and compassion and your kindness and your grace and your mercy, Lord, in the name of Jesus. May we continually experience your presence in our home, and your Holy Spirit would just overwhelm our home in the name of Jesus. We give you praise, Lord, and glorify you. I pray for marriages that are struggling and in turmoil, Lord. I ask that you bring healing to them in the name of Jesus. We commit them to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Pray your blessing upon them, that people would find you as Lord and Savior. Lord, through seeing your fingerprint upon that home, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus. Your intervention in that home, your healing of that home, Lord. Pray it be for your glory, for your kingdom, I pray in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We give you praise, God. Hallelujah. We give you praise, Lord. We worship you. We exalt your name, Lord. We glorify you. We praise you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Lord Spirit, pray that your Holy Spirit speak to hearts today. Men and women, young people, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Surely. Would you lead us in that song, Shirley?
This is my desire to
I give you my soul. In homes and in marriages, Lord. Oh, Lord, as our lives are filled by your Holy Spirit, our homes and our marriages would be a showcase, a display for your glory, I pray in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Heal marriages, strengthen marriages, Lord. Make them blessed and make them a blessing, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Shirley, would you come and lead us to the Lord in prayer? Amen. Pray blessing upon homes and marriages and single folks and whatever situation they find.
Lord, in you, we all have the firm foundation that we need for our lives and our futures. On you, God, we are well grounded. There is no shifting underneath our feet. We are on solid rock with you. And we thank you, Lord, that you taught us about what is most important. Number one, a relationship with you. Number two, relationship with each other. And in this very special area of relationship and marriage, you don't leave us on our own to figure it out. You made sure it was part of your word. And what we read in your word, when we apply it, God, it makes a difference. We thank you, Lord, for the truth of your word. We thank you, Lord, for your blessing in our lives, in every life. Married, single, however, Lord, you are with us. You love us. You teach us. You help us. You want to pour into us. You want to bless us. And God, may our answer to you be, yes, Lord, do it. Yes, lead us, God. Yes, help us. Help us to make the choices that honor you, that we will experience the best you intended us to know. We thank you, Lord, and we thank you that when we go from this house today, you are with us, Lord, for you have said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. You are with us, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless. Amen. God bless each one. Lord bless you. All right. Amen.
changing me.